Hey guys, Drift0r here. I'm bringing you another anti-rage quitting video, but this time from a different perspective. In the previous videos, I was running with a full party, and we'd roll up on some people that were obviously not in a full party, smash them really bad, and they'd all rage quit in about a minute. And a lot of you said that that was unfair, that they should have rage quitted, that you would have rage quit if you came against my party, etc., etc. So I wanted to show you from the other side of the coin, I wanted to show you that I don't rage quit even when I don't have a party, even when my friends that are particularly good at this game, even when they're losing, when I'm hopelessly outgunned, outskilled, outnumbered, when I've got random teammates running around, when it's set in stone that we're going to lose this game, or, you know, I would like to say that it's not set in stone, but you'll see very quickly here that it might as well be, because we're getting smoked, we're getting spanked and smacked around in every kind of way that you can be, but I'm not going to quit. I'm not going to roll over and die. I'm not going to take my jetpack and go and just blow on out of this game. See you later, guys. I don't feel like losing. I'm actually going to stay in this game, and as mad as it makes me, as frustrated as it makes me, I'm going to finish. And I'm going to finish this so that the other people can have their victory. It's a moral quandrum that I am always placed in, that I don't quit easily, I don't give up, I don't roll over and die, because I don't give up hope easily. I always have hope that we're going to come back and win, that I'm just going to take out my air support class and turn this game around and put myself on these flags, and we're all going to be good. And more than that, if the other people can beat me and my teammates that easily, that handedly, that well, they deserve their victory. They don't deserve to be cheated of their victory just because I'm not good enough to play on that same level. So you're going to get to see me get butthurt here. And I do have a reason for this. And the reason is that if you can't lose, then what's the point of winning? If you can't have black, then what's white? If you can't have good, then what's evil? One is invariably used to define the other. And the example that I would like to use is a Twilight episode. Not Twilight. No, Sparkly Vampire, sorry. Twilight Zone, which for those of you that don't know is an old 40s black and white TV show that still stands as one of the best TV series ever made. And it's scary as hell even today because the subjects they breach are not comfortable ones. But the episode that I'm going to talk about is called A Nice Place to Visit. And this episode is set in the early 1920s for gamblers. This is Prohibition area. This is where gangsters and gamblers and mobsters and all this was very, very common. See, I'm lagging here. Even through the lag, I'm not going to give up and quit. And what happens in this episode is a small-time gangster, big-time gambler, always in debt. He gets shot during a robbery, but wakes up in his bed and everything's fine. The world seems to be his oyster. He's always winning. People like him. He's friendly. And all of a sudden, an angel shows up, a man in white, that tells him that that gunshot actually killed you, and God decided that you needed your own personal paradise, so we sent you here. So here's this gambler, always lived his whole life struggling, wanting more, always wanting to win, always behind, trying to cheat to win, trying to stack the odds in his favor, and that's exactly what he does in his fantasy world. He plays all the games, he wins every game, and no game can he lose, no matter what risk he takes, no matter what impossible reward gambit there is, he always gets the reward. No matter what woman he gets, whatever woman he wants, he gets the woman. No matter what gets in his way, he takes it out. There was a scene with a policeman that says, you can't do that, that's not moral, that's not right. So he just shrinks the policeman down to kind of a scrawny guy and beats him up for the fun of it. And he just keeps going, thinking this is great, and he keeps asking the angel, why did God ever decide to send me to such a nice place? And the angel tells him that, this is what you deserve. This is what your whole life has been about, so we decided to give it to you. And he does, and he goes, and after a couple of months in this place, it just gets fucking boring. Every game he plays, he wins, no matter what, even when he's trying to lose, when he's trying to throw the card game, when he's trying to make a gamble too risky, too improbable or impossible, always winning, always cheating, never getting caught for it, nothing bad ever happens. And it just continues, and he starts to get jittery and scared and shaky, and it has the same outcome every time, no matter what, every single time. He always wins, and eventually he starts losing his mind and cracking up, and he asks the angels, like, why did God ever decide to send me to heaven? Why I deserve to be in hell. You need to send me to the other place, because he was getting desperate for a loss, because he needed to be reminded of what it was to win, because without the ability to lose, you can't win. And the angel simply says to him, this is hell. This is the other place. Whatever made you think that this was heaven? Heaven is not winning every single game. Heaven is not getting everything that you want all the time. Sometimes you have to lose. Sometimes you have to be beaten and broken and take a loss in order to enjoy the victories. And that's how I feel a lot of times. I always fight through to the end because improbable outcomes do happen. In other situations, it makes me feel good to know that I played as good as I possibly can, that I threw down as hard as I can, that I tried as much teamwork, as much tactics, and I gave every last bit of what I had, and I still lost. That somebody out there somewhere was still better than me, and what that means is that I can still get better. I haven't peaked out. There's still something to strive to. There's still something to want to be better than. If I was just the best, if I was on the top of my game at every single thing all the time, that every single thing I touched was perfect and golden and majestic and marvelous, then I would just give up. I would quit. Nothing would be interesting. If there was something that you couldn't do, you would want to do it more. I don't know, maybe that's just me. One of my big motivators is when people tell me that I can't do something, that I'm too fucking stupid to do something, that I should be in special education classes, that I'm too weak to be on a team, that I'm too dumb to compete in this level, that I can't write, that I can't act or direct, or any of these things that I do. That pisses me off. And I want to do better, even if maybe that person is a master or godlike at what they, whatever it is that they do. I want to be better than them. I want to put them down, and that's just naturally how I am as a human being. That's how you should be as a human being. But that's what these games are ruining for us. They're taking away the sweetness of our victories by removing the losses. Because in the single player games, a lot of times, especially nowadays when the medium might as well be like very easy from days past, it's setting up to just reward you. Oh, you win. Oh, you shot this guy. Walk in a line, shoot this guy. Walk in a line, shoot this guy. Play the cutscene. Oh my god, you're a hero. You're so talented. You saved the world by walking down the linear path and killing the bad guys. Let's hit those little happy centers in your brain over and over and over and over and over. And a lot of you, myself including, you're getting desensitized to this, to where it doesn't even matter. The games, you don't even care about the story or the characters because it doesn't matter, because you don't have to struggle for it. You can just waddle through it like a movie. And the same thing is becoming true of multiplayer. These games in Call of Duty, even the long ones, are 8, 9, 10 minutes tops. The short ones, 3, 4 minutes. And people can't stand to lose for 3 minutes, that they just have to just bail out on their little jetpack and nope right on out of there to some other game that's preset up, predetermined to where they can win. What you'll find in the long run is that this becomes very bland, very blasé, very boring. It turns into the same gray mash over and over and over and over, and it's no fun. Why the hell would you want to do that? That's why you talk to all these commentators that, I'm getting in that boat too, because I have to get gameplay sometimes for like the respawn episodes and stuff. You know, why don't you like these games? Why do you bitch so much? Why do you complain so much? Why do you rage quit? Why is your win-loss something like 0.35 something when I know you're an amazing player? And that's because they've lost sight of what it is to play a game. The risk, the reward, the challenge, the self-edification and glorification, all this is fading away, and people just want the win. They want to win, they want to win. They can't have the win, they're not going to do it. So, but if you made a game called I Win, just like the Gambler in the Twilight Zone episode, if the game was called I Win, nobody would play it. It'd be the most boring game ever to play I Win, because what happens? Every single time, oh, you win. You win, you win, you win. Jesus Christ, that would get boring. If I can't lose every now and then, if I can't get my ass handed to me now and again, I would never play a game. It would just be too boring to even bother with. These guys handed me my ass, and thank God they did. Now that I'm done lecturing you on the morals of playing Call of Duty, I would appreciate it if you would do something good for me, something good for yourself, and something good for somebody else. I'm still supporting Kristen Dunleavy and voting for her in order to help her win a handicap-accessible van. She is a wheelchair-ridden school teacher that lives in New Jersey, and National Mobility Awareness Month Foundation, McOrg, I forget the name of the organization actually, is holding a contest and allowing us to vote for users, and the users in the top 10% of votes will be put up to a judges panel, and the judges panel will choose to give out 2 or 3 handicap accessible vans. And the reason that I'm supporting her is because she is a full-time teacher and counselor that specializes in helping families with disabilities, giving back, and the van she has is a giant pile of shit that breaks down all the time. So I'd appreciate it if you would vote for her and use promo code 797 down there in the little box so that your votes count 5 times. You can vote every day. I've been voting every day. Some of you have been slipping off, but let's get another big boost right here at the end. Drift0r out.